was a new special effect this morning.
We've been investing in a new suite of effects, have we? We've increased the budget for effects. No longer, not merely horizontal. Do you know, someday we'll get up to that diagonal swipe, like Star Wars level budget, right?
Yes, I'm going to have to practice that one.
Yeah, empty coffee cup, though, I think.
Epic skills.
No kidding. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Yeah. Just checking out the weather report. It is a brilliant day here in Ottawa. It's going to be warm. It's going to be warm for the next few days. So, you know, we get our 1 week of summer in, and then we'll be back to winter probably. That's the way it goes. It's just the Canadian skepticism in me. Laura's asking, hey, Chris, how do we order a new mug? Laura, shoot me an email. I may be able to hook you up. Laura has a mug from a previous event. By the use of the phrase of new, Laura, did you break it? And Kevin's got his mug. Yeah. Chips, drops, those sorts of things. We understand. We've all broken a mug. I've broken a few in a backpack trying to take them to conferences, and they clank together and chips fly everywhere. So, yeah. Kevin's telling us, get some Timbits and celebrate summer. Yeah. Well, we won't even go to Timbit.
Those are the donut holes from Tim Hortons?
Yeah. Yep. Laura's explaining that her client broke it. Okay. Well, Laura, shoot me an email and we'll sort that out for you for sure. By the way, Laura happens to be in the Ottawa area, so this happens to be a kind of an easy problem to solve. Speaking of problems and, I'd say solving them, but we did have a pretty amazing and special episode last week where we were joined by Myra Roldan, Nyla Spooner, and Justin Jackson, who took over the session, ran it, an incredible session talking about racial injustice intersecting with the learning and development world. And I did want to share a couple of follow-up resources out of that session. One of them is that there was some amazing sharing in the chat. Lots of people shared things to, you know, other opportunities, books, resources, all kinds of things. We did send out a follow-up email from the idiotic email channel with that stuff listed. But in case you missed it, we've also posted that to dominKnow blog, and there's a link to that. There are just short of two dozen different books, resources. Some of the resources later on are almost curriculums in themselves around self-educating on the topic of racial injustice. I also wanted to pop in, this is something that I found over the weekend, a Twitter thread from a Canadian journalist, and I'm gonna post that in as well. And it's a really concise thread discussing and defining systemic racism, and I also wanted to actually pull two quotes out from it. So these are, keep in mind, these are tweets. So there are the fellow apologizes later for a couple of typos, but we'll pop that in there as well. What is systemic racism? It is not the belief that members of the society or organization are all secret Ku Klux Klan sympathizers or overt white supremacists. Instead, it is the observation that the systems we operate in have racist outcomes. The individuals within it do not have to deliberately think or act in racist ways for this to work. Either by accident or design, it will still have racist outcomes. And that resonated for me because in the L&D world, we do talk about, you know, measurable outcomes. Did behaviors change? The abstract and strange thing, you know, what did people learn when we give people a test? But we're always looking to produce measurable outcomes by creating behavior change. And so I think that thread is worth just looking at to understand maybe if you haven't grasped racism, you know, really can, really is, there's a very clear definition of it there and a good place to start working with. So wanted to share those resources as a follow-up to last week's amazing session and once again express our incredible honor that we felt that Jessica, yes, Myra, and Nyla all gave us their time and their openness, their honesty. We appreciate it very much. And we were just simply honored by that. So.
But this week, we're going to be doing some doodling and some drawing with our friend Kevin Thorn. How are you this morning, Kevin?
Doing well. Yourself?
Well, we're all hanging in there, I think.
We're hanging in there.
In this current COVID world, I don't know, what do we call it? Is there a name for what we're in right now? Do we still call it pandemic? I don't know.
I've just been referring to it as COVIDuary. It's the umpteenth of COVIDuary.
Well, then there's the because of the new sort of situation we're in, right about December 1st of next year, 2020, the next generation of the coronials.
I see what you did there. He said, doing the math of nine months calculation on a calendar. So, and by the way, COVIDuary, I'm very confident, is not my own coining. I'm very certain I found it somewhere else and just
I stole coronials from somewhere else.
So, excellent. Kevin, for those of us, I mean, you've been with us and we've done drink and draws, noting that drinking means coffee at this time in the morning for most of us. But you've been with us on this for this approach a few times. But for those who haven't joined us in the past, one of those episodes, give us a quick intro to yourself, a little bit of your background. Do people know where you're coming from?
Yeah. Kevin Thorn, Old Studios, affectionately referred to as the chief nuggethead of creativity and play and solving all kinds of learning problems. We over here. Also in the area of instructional comics, do a lot of work in studying the idea of visual communication. Getting into that academic deeper thinking of cognitive, the way our brain works when we look at pictures and images. So I'm bringing a lot of my art talent, if you will, my skill into the learning and development world and seeing where I can disrupt some things, if you know what I mean. So anyway, retired Army myself, spent a decade and a half in corporate and then started my own gig here doing this and just celebrated 8 years independent and all kinds of things. Do a lot of teaching and training and instructor up at the university teaching instructional design. And then for some reason, somebody twisted my arm and I'm joining the doctoral program this fall. So we're just gonna stack it on later.
Wow.
And we'll keep going.
That's a heck of an adventure that you're embarking on.
Yeah, well, you know, got to do something in my golden years.
Yeah. And I'm noticing, and I don't know if we've had it before, but we've added this week anyway, CNH after your name. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, given that we're a world of certificates and other sorts of acronyms and initials, et cetera, maybe just describe what that means.
Chief Nuggethead.
Okay, perfect. Just because you were talking about doctorals and, you know, and people see that C and they think certified. Oh, what's that program? So
it's kind of a, dare I say, it's kind of a poke at sort of that. Let's put a string of letters behind our name because that automatically gives us credibility, which we all know that's a longstanding debate because, so I didn't have any at the time. So I think, well, I'm going to just throw those numbers after. And I think you might have been, I think you're the second person that's been, do you know that's been there for about 4 years?
Okay.
And you're like the second person ever to ask you.
Well, I was noticing it because I'm not sure we've ever used it. I can see it for those above, yeah. You know, the frame here or whatever. I'm not sure we've ever actually put it. I don't recall us putting it in the episode.
Yeah, that's the whole name of the studio, Nuggethead Studios, yeah. Because we take ourselves too seriously too often, and we all every day make goobers and mistakes and bump heads and have, you know, do, you know, we just be transparent, be open. Let's do it. Let's get the work done. Be honest with it. Own your mistakes, you know, disagree respectfully, all that kind of stuff. And we're all nugget heads in a big picture.
Certainly are. Let's move on from that to what we're going to do, what we're going to draw about today.
We're going to draw Chris about today.
Get your pen and paper ready, everybody.
I guess we can start sharing my screen. I'm going to have my head down drawing. I'm going to have the iPad. So I'm going to need some moderators, if you will, somebody to tell me time and all that kind of thing.
Sure.
I'm just going to kind of draw and talk. And then just ask questions, because I'm not going to be looking at chat. So if anybody comes up with a chat or anything.
We got you covered, man. We got the chat. We got the ask a question section while Kevin fires talking about what he's doing. If you guys do want to ask questions, don't forget there is the ask a question link to the left of your chat.
So I'm going to start out here. I'm going to show you the technique I'm talking about. And it's a real simple technique, and we'll look at this. Basically, you're taking a photograph and you're tracing it. It's just the old common thing about tracing stuff. And then you just trace it with a line, fill it with color, and then you can get a little bit more detailed as you go along. Like, for instance, you see her scarf, and all it is just little lines. And, you know, if you've seen some of my other drink and draws, it's all about shapes. So everything is filled. If you look at just the shapes here, right? Now, if I back this out and I go to something a little bit more detailed, then you'll see here's a couple of photos I'm doing for some clients. You see this one's a little bit more detailed. And then this other one here, I can probably break this one down. This might look like a photograph to you. Does it look like a photograph to you?
Yeah.
It's not, because if you go all the way in, you can see the pixels and you can see the line, color lines. All it is, if you think of color by number, it's kind of the same thing. You're just pulling little color shapes out of a photograph and then filling it in with a fill color by drawing it. So if I take this apart, you'll see all the layers and all the pieces. So if I, let's see, we just turn these off, these different layers. Like, here's the shoe.
So just to be clear for everybody out there, this type of work does not fall under the category of rapid design, rapid e-learning development.
No, it does not. So here's the actual photograph of,
right.
And then when you draw you just follow the shapes and fill it in. And as you do the whole drawing, you do little sections at a time. And then the photo, oops, I forgot to turn these on and on. There we go. And then you can essentially pull it. Now there's filter, I'll be the first one to tell you, Photoshop, and there's a lot of filters out there that can do this for you. You know, erase the background, you can add hue, saturation, you can play with all these kind of filters, but in the end, it's still a filter. These are custom, and with custom, hand-drawn, if you will, you know, you can create photographs, you can create drawings that no filter can replicate this style, if you know what I mean. Yeah. And it kind of has that color by number kind of effect to it.
Probably. Question, maybe we'll ask it out loud before folks start asking it more fully, is tell us a little bit about what you're working in. It looks like today you're on your Mac rather than your iPad, like you've been in the past.
There's Chris.
Son of a gun.
I am using Procreate, which is an iPad Pro.
Oh, okay.
That's with my Apple Pencil.
Okay.
So let's just... we can do this one. Let's do my grandson. This is my grandson. Say, hi, Oakley. So what you do is you pull a picture in, and then you just size it how you want. Doesn't matter. Just the bigger the better, because you can play with it. Something like that. And then the first thing I do is in Procreate, we don't have time to go through all the tools, but there's a little magic wand tool up here in the upper left. And then I click opacity, and then you just slide. Now what happened? In fact, hang on. As soon as I'm trying to move fast, things aren't happening. Here we go. There we go. You just kind of bring that fade down, because I'm looking for the shapes. And the color is, you can do it with the color, but back it down about 50. And then I'm going to add a layer on top of that. Get a dark pen. And then a thin line. I don't want anything thick right now. Just send a thin line. And then now I'm just going to trace the outline. I'm just going to find the edges. That's all I'm doing. Now I'm going to go fast just for the sake of time. But all you're looking at is you're looking for the line. You know, this is not an ear right now. This is just lines. You've seen some of my other drinking draws. You got to break it down into the fundamental shapes. And you're just looking for the lines. Once you get all the lines outlined, and again, I'm going fast. I don't know if this is working the way it's going to, I don't know if it's going to turn out the way I want. But. And the idea is not to be precise. You're gonna, if you, the faster you go, and the looser, if you, is looser a word? Looser you go, then it's more organic. I'm going to imagine this line right here, so I'm going to put it right there like that. Now, a lot of times what I do is the first thing I'll do is the center, like the nose. So little baby, little button nose. So what we're going to do is just kind of just lightly trace around the edge of his nose here, just a little bit. That's all we need. And I don't know, maybe we can put a little line right there to make it look like a button. Now, when you do mouths and lips, mouth and lips are probably eyes, mouths, and hands are the hardest thing to draw.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the techniques with
confirm that
mouths, don't trace the outside, trace the inside. So we start with the inside line. And that's the shape of the upper lip. And we shape the bottom. And the other thing, practicing doing it, whether you ever do this or not, but practicing doing this gives you the sense of understanding anatomy and how proportions, how eyes and nose and mouths and all that kind of fit together. And then once you're done, then you can come back and play around and make them all cartoony and goof them up a little bit if you want. These little teeth are coming in right there. Now, sometimes you can do is just draw a little line on the bottom just to kind of define the top and the bottom, something like that. Now we're going to do the eyes. Like eyes, again, are very complicated if you want to get real detailed, but we're just looking for the lines. So I got this line. I've got this line that comes up around here. And then I've got this line that comes up around here. And then got the eye. And the people. That's all we're looking for. That's all we need. Happy little eyes. And then maybe a little bit of definition where the eyebrows go. Like so. Now we take this out and we hide that. There's the shape of our mouth. Or a shape of our head, if you will. Forgot the pupil. Yeah. Now,
today we make
prepare to do this. Turn the opacity back on. And you see that he's got a little bit of a smile in the cheek lines. I got to probably add the cheek lines because if I turn this one on and turn that off, it doesn't appear that this baby is smiling as much as the photograph. So what we want to do is we want to tweak it a little bit. And you can see my line right here. Whoops. You see my line right here at the edge. I want to come over a little bit more. Let me check this side over here. Yep, need to come over a little bit more. And then we got to bring in this line. And then we'll bring in this line. Now let's see if that makes a difference. A little better. The idea is that it's art. Whoops.
It almost looks like a baby.
Almost looks like a baby. All right, once we get generally where we want with that, then we grab another layer between the photo and the black line. And then this is what, it's a real cool feature in here. Way over here on the right, you see that little square between the two scroll bars on the right side, a little square button.
Okay, yep.
If I tap on that, it comes up a color picker. So I can find these colors I'm looking for. So all I'm looking for is one flat color right now that I want to color this face. So we got the dark, these are going to be the darker shades. And then we've got the lighter tones up here. So I'm looking for a mid-tone. So eyeball it right about there, maybe. And then we just color the whole thing in. We need a base color. And then I'll show you how this all comes together. It's about layering. You just kind of layer it all in.
Oh, because it's between the two. You don't have to worry about staying in the lines. You just go at it.
You just fill it in. And I can color the whole thing, but I want to kind of avoid the mouth and eyes right now.
Okay. So as you're doing that, and we're thinking about, you know, why do this kind of style on your own? I think for your next e-learning project is that being able to create a unique style in your imagery is really cool, because then you're not always reliant on clip art and the stock stuff that everybody else uses. And I think the other nice thing about it too is that you're able to make quick modifications and changes to it. If somebody says, mm-hmm. well, you know, we need the person to be wearing a red shirt because that's our corporate colors and not a white shirt, you could just go in and you just change the color fill, right?
Yeah, well, and I'm glad you brought that up. There's a couple of points on that. One is, you're exactly right. If you have that custom pose or that custom expression that you need from a character, take a photograph of somebody and then modify it and then draw your own. And then now you own that piece of artwork and you can use it, you know, freely as often as you like. And you mentioned color. That's one of the things with Procreate. If I grab this little color dot up here in the upper right corner, and maybe I don't like that tone and I want to go a little darker, maybe a different, maybe I don't know, maybe let's change it to purple. Maybe I want a purple baby. Then you just grab this dot and bring it in and it fills the whole thing for you. So you can change colors on the spot. You can change them pretty quick. I'm letting the screen catch up. I'm just now.
Yeah.
Hang on a minute. You'll see this.
I noticed there was a little bit of a delay as you were talking, but that's okay.
Well, I'm going to keep going.
Yeah. Keep going. It's all good.
So once you get the fill in place, then what we're going to do is we're going to keep adding layers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a layer on top of the skin tone layer, but I'm going to hide the skin tone because now I want to just focus on one element, and that's let's work on the mouth this time. So same thing, I'm gonna come down here, get my color picker, find a color that matches a little bit where I wanna be. And again, you're just roughing everything in. And you come back and add different shapes later. How much time we got?
Oh, about another 15 minutes.
Okay. Yeah.
This. Come in here like this. Those examples I showed when we first got started, those are all currently in client projects. Mm-hmm. Those are various projects that I'm working on. And again, when you're going through that visual style of a project, and then style is so subjective, you know, one style might not work for one project versus another style for another, but having a library of styles where you can present to a client and say, right. Hey, how about this? I mean, this seems to match the storyline, or this style seems to be the mood that we're looking for, you know, stuff like that. And then you give them the style options, but you're giving them options based on, hey, I know how to do this.
Yeah.
Then it ultimately, time and cost and all that, exactly. You know, it takes more time to make custom
sure
custom art.
It's something that I really value about what you, you know, the examples you showed us and what you're doing here is that you're using illustrations, but it's also not overly cartoony in that sense. It has to, it still has an aspect of realism, which, you know, for certain types of topics, et cetera, is also going to be, you know, I think a visually appropriate, you know, as you say, style.
You're exactly right. And another thing I want to point out too, this is not about skill. This is not drawing. This is about using a tool, just like any other tool that you take time to learn how to use, authoring tools, whatever. You take time to learn that tool and then you develop. Well, all I'm doing right now is developing. I'm not, this is no, there's no skill involved here. I'm just putting a photograph in here and trace, it's essentially tracing. It's all I'm doing. If you don't have an iPad or a tool like this, one of the things you could do is take the photograph and then put a regular piece of paper and tape it onto a glass window and use color markers and pencils. Same concept, same technique. And then afterwards you scan that in and take a picture of that drawing and photo, you know, and put it in. So it's neither here nor there. I mean, it's just, it's practice, right? So everything's about practice. You know, these, the eyes don't really give it justice here because he does have blue eyes. Let me give him some blue eyes.
Heather's got a question in the question panel. On average, how long does a facial portrait like this take?
Ah, great question.
Oh, and Eric is asking another a similar question. How long, what's Kevin's average time amount of time to render a portrait? How long did it used to take, and how much time have you been able to shave off by becoming more proficient?
Well, and that's just, and I'll answer the second question first. Yeah. Just like anything, when you practice something over and over again, whether it's drawing, it doesn't matter what skill. So in the context of drawing or learning different drawing techniques, you work on something and then you own it. You just do the same thing over and over again, 50, 100 times. And through that process, you will own a technique, your own style. And then you start, once you get to that point, then you start perfecting your own style. How can I be more effective? How can I be more efficient? How can I be streamlined? What are some things that I can do to, you know, what was the mistakes? You know, just like anything else that we do, lessons learned. And I can't emphasize enough, this is no different than anything you're already doing. It's just a different tool and a different technique.
Yeah. And the more you do it, the more you'll understand how much of a particular line, you know, there's, we can see maybe, you know, a shape actually seems to go further, but what's sort of the, you know, the minimum amount that you need to actually convey enough information to know, for instance, that this is a smiling baby.
Yeah.
And we talked about that in one of his last episodes, right? Doing the minimalist sketching. How many lines does it take for somebody to be able to see what it is that you're trying to draw? This is definitely a step up. I was going to drop something into the chat for Sierra. Maybe she could drop in some links from the previous episodes, because we started off really basic in the early drink and draws, helping people understand the shapes and the alphabet of sketching and thinking and drawing. And this is a little bit step up, but as Kevin said, it's definitely not impossible. Anybody can do this. It's just a matter of practice and obviously having the right tools in place to do it. But somebody mentioned, Deb in the chat mentioned her light box, and I was helping my mother-in-law clean out all of her. She's a former eye surgeon. And she's got one of these, and we were gonna throw it away. We were cleaning out.
Throw that away.
This box, and this is one of those boxes where you put X-rays up on it, and we were just gonna throw it out. And I was like, oh, wait a minute, that could be fun for tracing. So if you check this out when you turn it on, oops. Oh, of course, now it doesn't work.
Yeah, definitely hang on to that.
But. Oh, there we go. It'll be fun at some point to, it's just got a nice, it's a very nice fill. The light bulb that's in there still works a little bit. It'll be fun to do some tracing stuff. So haven't done anything with it yet, but.
Well, now you have a reason to play with that thing.
Totally forgot about that.
And there was a second part to to Erica's question, you know, do you use this for anything other than portraits?
Yes. We can do landscapes. You can do, anything. Just think of anything mm-hmm. that you typically would use in. It doesn't necessarily have to be work-related. You just take a photograph, take a picture of a flower out in your garden, and then do this technique. Take a picture of a piece of furniture, and then do this technique. It's the concept or the context of learning how to trace and see lines and see shapes with inside objects. And then that gives you a better understanding how you see visually and how you communicate visually. And then, as we talked about in earlier sessions, then you start stripping out the pieces that are just, are they adding value or is it just pretty stuff?
So, yeah. And even, for physical teaching, say, a physical piece of equipment, a technique like this might be a way to actually simplify the information. If you showed someone a photograph, there might be too much to try to, absorb for a novice, but you could use this technique to simplify it, to help people understand it a little bit, maybe more quickly initially, for example.
Yeah. I mean, not to get too all scientific-y in everything, but it could reduce cognitive load perhaps.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, there's a great quote by, I'll misquote it right now, but there's a great quote by Will Eisner who says, the art of drawing, you can do technical. So if you wanted to, for instance, like zoom in on a very intricate, complex part or something you're trying to explain, and you can't justify that with photographs, you can draw just a component or piece of the component that you want to zone in on, focus on, and you can do it all with illustrations. Mm-hmm. So the difference between illustrations and comic or cartoon, what is an illustration versus what is a comic? So you see what I'm doing now is I'm just adding some, I'm just kind of eyeballing it. And again, this is the part of practice. I know where, doing enough of these types of things, you kind of get an idea where shadows lie, light and shadow hits a face. So I'm not even using the photograph right now. I'm just kind of eyeballing it. And I might be totally off right here, but just trying for the sake of speed. This is where you just, like I said, you just keep playing around with this. Yeah, that's good enough for now.
Another use for this would be you might be provided with a lot of visuals, photos, etc. from a client project, but they all have different color tones. They all have different styles to them or whatever. And this is another way to maybe unify that more fully across your whole project, because you could then, start to control some of the aspects of that so that things have a cohesive feel and don't just feel like a bunch of shots from someone's phone, for instance.
Yeah, no, exactly.
See, so I think this is where the skill comes in, Kevin. You don't give yourself enough credit, right? Because this whole shading thing that you're doing.
Yeah, this is skill at this point.
This takes a little bit of an eye.
let me, you're exactly right, but I've got 30 years of practice behind me, too. I'm not showing off by any ways. It's, if you put the time and practice, I can show you the techniques. I can teach you all of the techniques and tips on how to get started. I can't control your own time and willingness to practice. That's on you. Mm-hmm. If you want to practice, you'll develop the skill. It's anything we do. If you want to be a master chef, spend 100 hours in the kitchen. That's all part of it. And that's all I'm doing here. So me eyeballing the shadow, yes, that's based on experience and skill that I've picked up over the years. So then, it would take somebody else maybe, starting out longer, because you have to look at this drawing, you have to look at the photograph again. And then what I would recommend doing in something like this is, get your color tone or whatever you're doing here. Hang on. I don't know how the camera's catching out. But let's say you got a line right here. So what you do is you look at this again. And again, you have to look past the photograph. Look past the photo and look for the shapes. So, and this takes time to learn how to do. So if I actually were to do this, I would start up here and I would draw this line. See that line I just drawn there?
Yep.
And everything to the right of that would get filled in that darker shade. And then maybe over here, you see over next to the nose, I would draw this shape. When you see these shapes, this is how you start, right? Just find the shapes. And once you find the shape, then you fill, it's like paint by number. Just outline the shapes you're looking for where the different shades are.
Mm.
And then that, then it comes into, and I'm going to back out of this and I'll show you another example. Here's one I'm working on right now.
Oh, I thought you were going to pull that one up of Chris.
Well, I was going to work on Chris, but I decided to do my grandson instead.
Do the baby instead. Okay.
Yeah, go with the babies. There's enough ugliness in the world.
So when you look at this one, you see lots and lots of, it's more intricate and it's more detailed in terms of shape. And if I turn off the color, turn on the photograph, I still have to do the jacket and shirt and everything. But if you turn off the, you kind of go back and forth here. So it's not a photograph. So it's an illustrative caricature. I don't know what you call this style. But
I think I've seen it just referred to as stylized.
You know? Stylized, filterized. Mm-hmm. Now, to go back to who was it that asked about how much time? This character here. Same thing. So if I go back, and I actually did this, this kind of helps give you an idea. There's the original photograph, there's the drawing, and then the tracked time in Procreate was 5 hours and 41 minutes.
That's hilarious. It tracks your strokes too. That's awesome.
So we go back over here to my baby, and we look at canvas information, statistics. So far, we've worked on the baby for 21 minutes with 170 strokes.
Hmm.
Not bad.
And so 21 minutes, let's turn it all on. Let me turn that layer off. Turn that off. You're pretty darn close. Now, what I would do, let's say I got to the end here, right? I'd go back to that dark, that line, you know, our outline. I'd go back to that layer at the top. And then I'd give it a little thicker line. And then what we're going to do is we're going to come in here and really bold this line. That's why that first initial little thin line is just outlining it.
And then that just kind of gets the ball rolling.
Now you're just kind of shaping it. You know, like if you ever done any woodworking, you know, you do the rough cuts, and then after you get it all assembled, your shelf or your box or whatever, your birdhouse, then what do? You go back and you sand it, refine it, put some stain on it, and then you start polishing it. This is that step, right? Once you get it all put together, you come back and you start fine tuning and polishing it up, like so.
Yeah, I can totally see where this is going from here too. This is great. So how many of you out there in the chat right now are frantically looking for an app and going to go practice this today? Because, you know, you're at home working from home and you don't have anything else to do. You might as well practice.
What else do you have to do?
That's an interesting take, Erica. She says tattoo artists would call it illustrative realism.
Yeah, that's I like it. Illustrative realism. Okay. There was a. Well, you've heard me say before, big instructional comic that I'm working on for India.
Oh, yeah.
They wanted to do a poster of all of the facilitators in India as a way to, not so much as a comic, but just sort of an illustrative realism. Thanks for that term. To kind of insert. So when we do the credit screen at the end of the course, these are the contributors. So I started playing around with this style back then, about a year ago, and they fell in love with it. And they said, "Oh, this is great. Can we do that?" And I thought, okay, well, I like putting this together. So that led to another project. That led to another project. And now it's, here's another, somebody asked another, here's one I'm working on now too. That if you look at this, these are just shapes in a pair of jeans.
Oh, nice.
And it's just four colors for the jeans and gray tones, three, four colors here. And it looks like three colors. There's four colors here. So if you kind of, if you restrict yourself, I'm not going to use any more than three colors or four colors, and then just find the shapes. And then if we turn on the photograph, it looks like I moved my character down a little bit. Just moving that. So if we look at the photograph compared to So there's the photograph. And you look at that and you say, oh my gosh, that's so detailed. There's no way I'm going to be able to trace all of those highlights and shadows and lights and stuff. And again, when you zoom in, what's really great about Procreate, you can really zoom in and you can see, you know, there's a, you know, you see right here, there's a color right there. Oops, come on. There's a color right there. That might be too thick. See that highlight right there? You just come in and draw the highlights. Or you come in here and you just say, okay, I want this highlight. And then I want this highlight. And then I want this one. And just let your brain go fast, because if you slow down and you think about it too much, that's when you get frustrated. So you go through that process, and again, it's practice. You go through that process, and then it ends up looking something like that. And then what I'm doing is I found this photograph. I found that photograph, but I needed a bigger streak. So then I used this photograph as a way to get me a basic street that I wanted to walk on, but I don't need that detail of a street. So then I sketched the street and took out a lot of the details. And then I'll come in and I'll use really flat colors, subdued, maybe a contrast. So you got these dark grays and blues on this character. So I might use some warmer tones like burgundies and rust oranges and stuff like that for the background. And then the back, so you want the focus on the character. And then when I'm done with that, then we can add some filters like blurring it up or whatever. So speaking of filters, there's where's that liquify? This is fun. Ready? Watch this. We can make a cartoon out of it, right?
Silly putty.
Caricature.
Yeah, now you can really play with your character. You turn all these other ones off. There, see, now you can, like, oh, I see, now I got a really cool looking character. So now you can push, using Liquify and Procreate, you can kind of push your ideas farther than just a photograph to where it can truly come from. And then you come up with stuff like that. So anyway, that's the fun.
Erica is commenting, that's disturbing. Which, yeah, it we're starting to tip into maybe the horror movie category to a certain degree there.
Illustrative non-realism.
All right. So then when you get done, here's so I got all this, and let me show you. And then Procreate I typically keep all the layers if I got to come back. So what I'll do is I'll come back over here to the main drawing. I'll duplicate it. And then I'll come in and then merge all these layers into one image. I don't need the photograph anymore because now I've got, this is like my output file. The other one's right. The file, right? Now I can play with these filters a little bit more. So if I wanted to do something like this.
Ouch.
Right? So now you can play around with the whole drawing. You know, if you want to, the crystal one's kind of cool. So you take the crystals. I don't know if you can see that or not.
I don't think it's updated yet.
Distortion. See how it's moving there?
Oh, I see. It's kind of pixelating it a little bit more there.
So you're kind of giving it more of a chalky. Like a, maybe it's like looking through glass or something.
Yeah. Super cool. As always, Kevin, we're pushing up on the end of our time here. Super, super cool. I now you got me thinking about not getting a new computer, but just getting an iPad.
I spend as much time in this iPad as I do my computer, so.
Oh, dang it. Now I got to figure that out.
Now you've still got to wrestle with it, Brent. You've got to figure it. No easy decisions in this world. Well, as always, Kevin, thanks so much for sharing that with us. It's got a lot of wheels turning in the chat too. A lot of folks are, well, I think some folks were even looking up light boxes on Amazon right now already. So
yeah, I've got one old school that's got the big fluorescent bulbs, inside the box, and you turn it on and you hear that hum.
I was just going to say, does it have that hum too? Yeah, nice.
Yeah, it's actually it's kind of therapeutic because you hear that hum while you're drawing.
So a little light noise is good for you.
I was going to say a little helps block out distractions maybe.
Yeah, for sure. Anyway, we've got some great other guests coming up I want to tell everybody about to get ready for. So don't forget to follow us on the Crowdcast channel. Follow the Domino Crowdcast channel, and you'll get notifications every time we add new things. And when Sierra updates stuff there, you can do that. And don't forget idiotic, IDIODC.com. You can go check out some of the past drinking draws with Kevin if you want to ramp up on some of the basic stuff that he's already talked about. And we have Nyla Spooner's going to be coming back and being a guest in a couple weeks. Next week we got Nick Floro joining us, and so we've got a lot of great guests coming up. So get your fix while you can, because we also take August off, and then we start our new season in September. So we've only got a handful of shows left, right, guys?
Then we put our feet up and relax.
It's summertime, people. I hope you guys all enjoyed that. Kevin, you want to drop in your links and emails and websites and all that cool stuff while we dance out of here?
Dance away.
Thanks, everybody, for joining us. As always, lots of good stuff in the chat, lots of good sharing. We really appreciate that. And we'll catch you guys next week.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, guys. We're coming back in July.
Yeah, we'll be back in July. The only month we take off is August. And you're coming back in July. Yes.
We just haven't picked the date yet. Three of us, we're back in July.
Yes.
Okay. You will be back. Everybody's coming. Here comes the Zoom.
Thanks, everybody.
Circular effect today.
Bye, gang.
See you, bye.
See you later.